Well, let me open us up in prayer, then we'll get to it. Lord, we thank you for our time together today. Thank you for Rob and his church, burgeoning EPC. And Father, we pray that this material that we share would spur us on to love and good works, to do your good and your perfect will in our churches, specifically, Lord, helping us in, to engage with those who are far away from you, to establish a relationship with them in order to share the gospel, Lord. So bless us now as we work together and share information, and may it bring you great glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So the we're from Tampa, and the title of the presentation is Building an Evangelistic Culture. The mission. And so the mission of the EPC, I'm sure you heard this a lot during Presbytery, carry out the Great Commission of Jesus as a denomination of Presbyterian, Reformed, Evangelical, and Missional congregations. Now, the Presbyterian and Reformed part of that mission statement, we can readily identify with, but the Evangelical and Missional portion of the statement is sometimes lost in our Presbyterian world. So when we talk about evangelical, we're really talking about gospel proclamation and getting back to gospel proclamation in our churches as an institution and also as individuals. When we talk about missional congregations, what we're saying is that every member in the church, they really do see themselves as a missionary on mission in God's field. And so as church leaders, yes, we have our polity, and yes, we have our Westminster Confession of Faith, and those are high points, but we also want to be evangelical. We want to be focused on proclaiming the gospel, and we really want to empower and equip our members to see themselves as missionaries, and not only at work, but also in the home and any place that the Lord would send them. So the focus really is evangelical and missional. When we think of all of the gospel priorities for us and for the church planting and for world outreach and even discipleship with effective biblical leadership, being evangelical and missional really plays into those four gospel priorities as well. And so the question to be asked is, hey, your church's commitment to evangelism on a scale of 1 to 10, you know, what do you, how would you see your church's outlook on evangelism as a whole, not just the evangelism warriors in the church, but the church's overall ethos when it comes to evangelism? And so we will hold this question, and then after we walk through the presentation, I'm going to put that up again. And so we really take our marching orders from the Great Commission. And we know the Great Commission passages, of course, if we come to Matthew 28, we know what Matthew 28 says, but also in Mark 13, John 20, and Luke 24, those contain the Great Commission passages as well. And what they all have in common is this idea of gospel proclamation, not just to Jews, but also to the nations. And so we know the story. It's after the resurrection. The disciples meet Jesus where he tells them in Galilee. And we pick up in verse 18, Jesus says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Now, of course, this is the most famous of texts when we talk about the Great Commission. And we see that this mission is entirely based on Jesus's authority. And so he says all authority, not only in heaven, but on earth, has been given to him. And this idea of going also implies being sent. And we see that as the gospel stories continue to unfold in the book of Acts. And so this verb of making disciples, it also includes, when we talk about imperatival force, it also includes baptizing and also teaching. And this idea of the Great Commission, gospel proclamation to the nations, is possible because of what Jesus promises to do there at the end. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. So we go because we are sent, and we're sent by one who has all authority in heaven and on earth. And he also promises to be with us to the end of the age. So the most famous of Great Commission passages, of course, we see that in Matthew 28. And so everything, of course, that stems from the Great Commission is played out there in Acts 1:8. Jesus, before he ascends, what does he say? But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Everything in Matthew culminates with the Great Commission. But what we see in Acts is that everything flows from the Great Commission in those 28 chapters. And so the application for us is not to ignore the Great Commission, because if we ignore the Great Commission, it simply tells us that we are being disobedient as church leaders, as churches. And if we think of this on a practical level, if we are the ones who have authority in the workplace and we issue instructions, and we will call them lawful instructions to the workplace, and they're not complied with, then the worker, even in the home, mom and dad, the children, they're being disobedient to those lawful instructions. And in the same way, the same can be said of us for ignoring this Great Commission given to us by our Lord. If we ignore the Great Commission, it also follows that we're relying on transfer growth. And this is huge when we think of transfer growth, especially during COVID. A lot of churches would say coming out of COVID, we actually did better than when we went in. And so the next question is, well, was that conversion growth or was that simply transfer growth? People coming from other churches for whatever myriad of reasons that existed in their individual circumstances. So primarily as churches, we do not want to rely on transfer growth. We want to be obedient to the Great Commission and rely also and place great emphasis on conversion growth. And so here is Tom Rainer's book, The Autopsy of a Deceased Church. Even in our session, when we were walking through this together, we prayed this prayer several times in our session meetings. Lord, remind us that we are to be Great Commission Christians in a Great Commission church. Remind us that in your strength, we are to do whatever it takes to reach out into our community with the transforming power of the gospel. And so that is something that has to start with church leaders and the individual churches must find a way to communicate this to the congregation at large. And so for our church, I became the pastor in 2019. I basically grew up in this church. And in 2019, I became the pastor. And of course, we walked through COVID and a myriad of church issues in 2021. And in 2022, I recognized that our church was in recline. Now, of course, when a church is planted, it's said to be in incline. Why? Because this purpose, this objective, the churches have goals, they're establishing structure, they're growing, you know, a lot of fun growth is taking place. But then once programs are established and the church exists to manage programs and forgets and ignores the Great Commission, a church is said to be then in recline. And the only way to go after recline really is decline. And all of these symptoms start to take place in the church. Nostalgia, for instance. Church leaders would say, well, let's go back to the way things were. There's polarization because everyone thinks that they have the solution to the problem. People start to fall off and ultimately a church dies. But what we really want is when a church finds itself in a season of recline, don't go back. Do not go down, but launch another season of incline. You know, refocus then on why the Lord has called you to that zip code. why the Lord has placed you there, and reestablish or refocusing on the Great Commission. And so the purpose really of this conversation is really to help churches to refocus, no matter where they are in their life cycle, on becoming Great Commission churches. And so we see the focus then on churches in recline is the congregation. You know, what are the congregation's needs? Of course, we're supposed to take care of the congregation, but we don't exist, you know, primarily for the congregation. We exist to make disciples. And then, of course, growth. We rely heavily on transfer growth. As two walk out of the back door, two come in through the front door. Tell a story about this, that when we first entered into the EPC and I had to fill out that paperwork, you know, at the end, all of the metrics of our church, the question was asked about baptisms. We did fine answering the infant baptism question because, I mean, we have a lot of millennials and they were fruitful and they were multiplying, and that was great. But as far as adult baptisms were concerned, we did not have any. And that was a stark reality for me as a new pastor of this church, saying where our focus should be. And it's not just to answer the questionnaire, but it really did tell me that we weren't placing the proper emphasis on evangelism. And so in 2022, I made the decision as a pastor. I said, we must embrace a culture of evangelism. And I became a church health coordinator, went to training, and Dean Weaver said this: a healthy church is one that has an evangelistic culture and does evangelism. And that statement stuck with me in my drive home coming down Interstate I-4, because we're about 100 miles or so away from the office of the General Assembly. That statement was very significant and poignant in that time in our church's history, in my life, my time as the pastor. And so looking at embrace, culture, and evangelism, just want to break these words down just a little bit. And when we talk about embracing, we think about Luke 15. And of course, we know that the son is coming home and his father sees him, he feels compassion upon him, and he went and he embraced him. When we look at that word, it literally means that he fell upon his neck. It's the same thing that Esau did to Jacob and the Ephesian elders did to Paul before he left. And when we think of this idea of falling upon someone's neck, well, a person's neck is not that strong. And a full-grown adult falling upon another's neck really does cause a significant amount of strain because of the force that's exerted. And so we literally want to do that, fall upon this idea of evangelism in our churches in the same manner, literally. Talk about culture. John Frame, former professor of mine at RTS, has a good definition of culture in a talk that he gave back in 2001. Culture is what we make, and it begins right after creation in response to God's command. Culture is not only a fact, but it's also a value. It's not only something that happens, it's something that God desires and something that God values. Well, we know that God is responsible for creation, and the raw materials that he has left us is what we use to make culture. And we are supposed to make that which glorifies God, because it's something that he values, therefore something that we should value. The Luzon Committee on World Evangelism on Culture says it's an integrated system of beliefs, values, customs, and institutions that binds a society together, and it gives it a sense of identity, dignity, security, and continuity. And those three things there is really what we want to see around this idea of evangelism in churches. It's something that the church values. It's something that the church can be said to be the church's identity. And also there's continuity in the way that the ministries operate when it comes to an evangelistic culture. There's a complement there. And so for session members, for leaders of the church, I think it really does begin with valuing what God values. And as we look in Matthew 28 and the other Great Commission passages, it is the Great Commission. Now, thinking about the competing values in the church, there are many cultures within any church where people would value differing things, and they would do that in many groups. And so it is the job of the church leadership, the session then, to identify competing values or many cultures within the church that's not consistent with the overall value of the church. And in this case, we're talking about the Great Commission. I think once that value is established, then churches really need to figure out how do we weave this Great Commission into every fabric of the church. And in this particular case, we're talking about making disciples, and that's through evangelism. And that is the task of church leadership. And so this is a great think tank session, opportunity for sessions to think about the values of their church, what competes with that, and how they can communicate properly to congregations what the church values, because it's what God values. So looking at the what, the who, and the how of evangelism, here's all the things, you know, just a few things of what evangelism is not. You know, back in the day, it was inviting an evangelist in to preach. The big tent meeting revivals, the Billy Graham crusades, everything that the pastor doesn't say, the evangelist is going to say. And so that's not evangelism in the strictest sense of the word. It's not inviting people to church. It's not a personal testimony. It's not outreach and service, and neither is it apologetics. And what these things are not is evangelism, but what they are is what we would call pre-evangelism. It is establishing common ground. It is establishing relationships with people, entering into dialogue with others, exercising empathetic listening, understanding presuppositional barriers, which is very, very important. If a person is man-centered and they believe that they are the source of ultimate truth, then there's a presuppositional barrier that when we share the gospel with them and we say that man is inherently sinful, that it's going to go against their presupposition. And so we want to understand what presuppositional barriers those that we're engaged in conversation with, that they have. And all of this is really a preparation for gospel communication. And we also have to realize that it doesn't happen overnight. Keon, a young man who shared at General Assembly, the exegeting your neighborhood portion, he did a really good job in breaking down how to prepare to have gospel communications, churches to prepare to have gospel communications. He emphasized things like prayer walks. You know, how many times do church leaders or members of the church, you know, walk in there around the neighborhoods of their church and pray for the needs of the neighborhood? What does your neighborhood look like? That speaks of neighborhood mapping. And how do you rightly engage with those in your neighborhood? And what are the things that take place in your neighborhood that call you to bear with those that live in close proximity to your church? So these are just some things that church leaders should be thinking about and praying about and communicating to church members concerning how to prepare for gospel communication in their 1, 3, or 5 mile radius of the church. So pre-evangelism. And a good book recommendation is J.I. Packer's Evangelism and the Sovereignty of God. It's a good read, and it's thick, and rich with theology and practical wisdom for sharing the gospel. And Packer, in his book, he breaks down these four things concerning the gospel. Faithfully proclaiming the gospel. The gospel first is a message about God. And Packer would say, before we would know God as Redeemer, then we have to know him as creator. And Gospel is a message about sin, how sin separates from God, and how someone who is sinful is under the wrath of God, and how sin affects the totality of our being. And this is so important here when we think about the second one. If a person does not realize in a gospel conversation that they are a sinner separated from the love of God, then it's really going to be tough for them to understand the good news about Christ. And so the good news, the gospel is a message about Christ. And here we're talking about Christ, his person and his work, you know, his sinless life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection, and his ascension. And so it's all about the person and work of Christ. And these are what we would call gospel facts. And when we are sharing gospel facts, then we are evangelizing. And then none of this takes place without a summons to faith and repentance. And we'll discuss this here when we get to the three circles. But these four gospel facts, a message about God, message about sin, message about Christ, and a summons to faith and repentance, really does encapsulate what an evangelistic message should contain. Should be compelling, should be clear, concise, and also it looks different and sounds different in the context in which it is shared. Like this quote here from J.I. Packer, it is a message of some complexity needing to be learned before it can be lived by and understood before it can be applied. It needs, therefore, to be taught. And when we talk about the practical things at the end of this presentation, this training in the three circles is a wonderful way to teach the evangelistic message. And so the who, of course, it's the lost. Looking at Matthew 15 and the common denominator in all of these stories, there's great rejoicing for the one sheep that's found. It's great rejoicing for the lost coin that is found. And of course, the father invites the older son to rejoice with him and come into the banquet when the younger prodigal comes home. And so what these three stories tell us is that there should be great rejoicing when a sinner comes to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, because that is what is taking place in heaven, and that should also be taking place on earth. And it really is humbling, and it should be humbling for us to know that we are participating in something that is eternal, and that's something that is greater than ourselves. And so joy is the common denominator here. And so pitfalls to overcome. I like this book here by Randy Newman. It's called Mere Evangelism. It's 10 insights from C.S. Lewis to help you share your faith. And what Newman does is he scours all of C.S. Lewis's writings and basically comes up with a compendium of C.S. Lewis's understanding and writing concerning evangelism. And here, when we talk about pitfalls to overcome, fear is a big one for many Christians in sharing their faith. I would say more so fear over pride. And so the illustration that Randy Newman gives is, you know, if you have $100 and someone takes that $100 from you, your net worth is zero net worth. That's basic math. But if you have $1 billion and someone takes $100 from you, it's the same loss. It's $100, but the impact is significantly different. And so when we think in terms of what our net worth is in Christ, it's worth billions on top of billions on top of billions. And if we truly really get that into our understanding, into our imaginations, and live that out, then when someone says, you know, I really don't want to hear that good news, or when someone rejects the gospel message, it should not affect who we are in Christ. And I think sometimes Christians should go into gospel conversations, understanding who they are in Christ and being able to come out of that conversation, not feeling unworthy or feeling less than what they should be based on the response of another. So the goal here is to understand our net worth in Christ, and what we're sharing is really good news, and it's something that should be shared no matter the response. Of course, the meaning of marriage, Tim Keller and Kathy wrote this book, and I think it's one of the best books on marriage out there. But there's something that Tim talks about in the book, the power of truth in love. Now, if we have in a marriage, someone that is always speaking truth and there's no love, we just really call that criticism. You this, you that, you this, you that. It's just truth. And there's no love. If another person in said marriage is all about love and all about love and not sharing any truth, then there's an appearance of oneness in the marriage, but there's really not oneness there. That's just continuing to compromise one after the other after the other. But what we want to do is speak the truth and speak the truth in love. Because you love that person so much and you love what Christ has done in this world so much that it compels you to speak the truth. Love this quote by Jack Miller. He says that some Christians want to run in and confront others with the gospel without taking time to build a relationship of trust. Others are wonderful at building relationships, but never take the next step and lovingly confront their friends with the claims of Christ. He says, I have been guilty of both mistakes. And I can absolutely raise my hand and say the same thing. Think about those longstanding relationships that we have, and how many times have we taken the time to share the gospel in those relationships or withheld the truth for fear of offending another person. And these are just some things that the people that we minister to will struggle with, that really we can speak to in helping them share their faith. And so how, and talk about readiness, the how of evangelism is about being ready. Our associate pastor, a lifelong mentor of mine, his name is Lou Callagher. He says in a sermon one time, he said, what if we made it our daily practice to ask God to open doors so that he might provide divine appointments within the mission fields he has placed us in? And so individually, we have to think about mission fields as our neighborhoods, our workplace, and then wherever we traverse throughout the day. And one of the questions that I like to ask people who would listen to this presentation is, can you name your neighbors, those in front of you, those behind you, and those on either side of you? And if so, what kind of relationships do you have with them? And if you can answer that question, how often, if ever, do you pray for the Lord to grant you a divine appointment with them to be able to begin a gospel conversation? So this really is something that we must be intentional in every single day, is being ready to meet that divine appointment that the Lord establishes for us, but we have to pray for it. Talk about that when we get to the three circles as well. Methodologies. Okay, the principle. This is from Packer's book, Evangelism and the Sovereignty of God. The principle that the best method of evangelism is one which serves the gospel most completely. Major emphasis on this. We can have the best method, we can have the best tool, but we have to have a broken heart for lost people, because this lends itself to any method. There is a something to be said for those who truly have a broken heart, for those who are lost, especially those who have come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and you know what your former condition was before Christ. It must break your heart to see those without Christ. And this just takes time, and it takes discipleship for those who are not inclined to even think that way. when we think about how as well, we're going to think of our Bible tool, but also think of the arc of redemptive history, the meta narrative, if you will. We see that creation, fall, and redemption. We see that right there in the first three chapters of Genesis, and of course, the consummation. And this is a biblical theology approach, and systematically, it's the same meta narrative. Theology, the study of God, what we know about God to be true. Anthropology, what's true about man. Soteriology, what's true about Christ. And eschatology, what's true of God's promise. So either from a biblical theology perspective or a systematic theology perspective, the gospel facts remain the same. And so we think that the EPC has endorsed this book, Turning Everyday Conversations into Gospel Conversations, written by Jimmy Scroggins. And if you've ever read the book, the Jimmy Scroggins kind of lays out in this book their approach. They believe that God has called them there in the West Palm area to establish 100 churches in 10 years. And that comes out to 10 churches a year. And so how are they going to do that? Well, not relying on transfer growth. They're going to do that by relying on conversion growth. And in order for that to take place, they would say, we must turn everyday conversations into gospel conversations. And so for Jimmy Scroggins and the churches there, the family churches, it's all about overseeding the seeds of the gospel. And it's empowering church members, laity, to do this. And in so doing, they will, God willing, meet the goal of 100 churches in 10 years. And so it's through turning everyday conversations into gospel conversations. And so this is the three circles tool that Jimmy Scroggins came up with and which the EPC has adopted as an evangelism tool. Now, you can go to Life on Mission and the Three Circles presentation that I'm about to just walk through here. You can download that app on your telephone. And so you go to Life on Mission. It's the mission organization. And you can download that app on your phone. And also they have the brochures here, the conversation guide, Three Circles conversation guide that you can also grab in a bundle. And if you haven't read the book, you can also purchase the book as well. And I think there are some bundles, deals that you can get this book on. And it would be nice for churches when embarking on establishing an evangelistic culture in their churches to give a copy of the book to each person that is being trained in evangelism. And so this first circle here speaks of God's design. And of course, when we open up to the pages of scripture in page one, we see that God creates everything perfectly according to his design. And everything that God creates, God declares it to be good. And on the sixth day, and this is just an example of how you have this conversation with others. And of course, context also drives the conversation. But on the sixth day, God creates the crown of his creation, and that's Adam and Eve, our first parents. And God tells them to be fruitful and multiply. God empowered them to live according to his design, because God has a design for everything. And to stop here, it's what Jimmy Scroggins will say is how one pivots in the conversation. If someone's having a problem with their marriage, or someone's having a tough time in life, and you know, through conversation, you realize that, hey, this tough time that they're having is not according to God's design, and they're not living according to God's perfect design for their lives. This can open up the conversation to simply say, you know, so-and-so, God has a design for everything. He has a perfect design for your life. He has a perfect design for your finances, for your marriage, etc. And as we walk, and then you go back to the original gospel, the original creation story, and this is where it all began. And so God empowers Adam and Eve to live according to his design, but our first parents did not want to live according to God's design. We know that they wanted to live according to theirs. And so this is called sin. And sin is rebellion against God. It's an affront against a holy God. And what does sin do? Sin leads to separation and alienation from God. And that was never according to God's perfect design. And sin leads to brokenness. And sometimes people would start the conversation. You can start the conversation with brokenness. When we talk about pre-evangelism and establishing common ground with someone, a simple question is this. Don't you see that the world is broken? Aren't there things in the world that tell us that it's broken? And what do you think some of those things are? And of course, the person that you're having a conversation with, they'll name the many things that are happening in the world that they see that speaks of brokenness. And then you simply go back to God's design. Well, this was not the way it was supposed to be according to God's design because of sin. Sin leads to the brokenness that we see in the world. And now we make it personal. It also leads to the brokenness that we witness in our own lives. And then we can talk about some of those things that a person witnesses in their lives that speaks of this brokenness. And then to really say also that the good thing about brokenness is that it does wake up the need in us for change in our lives. But no amount of self-help, no amount of drugs, no amount of alcohol, no amount of professional counseling can ultimately fix this brokenness that we witness in our lives. And so the change then does not come from the inside out. The change has to come from the outside in. And these squiggly lines, they represent the feeble attempts that man makes to elude and get out of the state of brokenness. But God does not leave us and does not want to leave us in a state of brokenness. He's done something about it. And so now here's the setup for the good news of the gospel. And of course, we can, you know, pull out some of the, like Galatians 4:4, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son into the world, born from woman, born under the law. But the gospel tells us that in the fullness of time, at the right time, God sent his son into the world. God became flesh. And it's the good news of Christ, of God inbreaking into time to do what? And again, being concise, being clear, and being compelling, simple, to live the life that we should have lived according to God's perfect design. And of course, die the death that we deserved for our sin and rebellion against God. So we're just walking through and having this conversation. And now we get to the good news of the resurrection, a good illustration that Jimmy Scroggins gives in his book. He's in the Philippines and he's given a gospel presentation. And he talks about the life of Jesus. He talks about the death of Jesus. And then he calls for a response, and he forgot the hallmark of the story. And of course, the hallmark is the story of the story is that death was not the final word, because on the third day, he rose again from the dead. And of course, this is what distinguishes Christ from all of the false messiahs who have ever lived, the truth of the resurrection. And so we really want to high spot the resurrection in our gospel presentation, because Christ was declared to be Savior and Lord, and the only one who can forgive our sin and heal the broken areas in our lives. And he did that of course, we know that the theological language as an atoning sacrifice for us, Christ did what we could not do for ourselves. So he's the only one who could forgive our sin and heal the broken areas in our lives. And so the proper response to the good news of God's saving love for us in the person and work of Jesus Christ is to repent and believe the gospel. And so I love the way the confession talks about repentance. And what is repentance unto life? It's a saving grace whereby the sinner, out of a true sense of his sin, he apprehends the mercy of God in Christ. And in doing so with grief and hatred, he hates his sin and he turns from it and he trusts in Christ. And I think that's so important because true repentance is a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of attitude, and a change of will. And so that that true saving repentance, of course, leads to faith as well. Some say believe, some say faith. And the common word used today is trust. So repent from seeking to live according to your own design and trust in the one who lived and did everything and secured a right relationship to God on your behalf. So repentance and faith. And, you know, looking back behind the veneer, looking back behind the paradigm, we know if we're talking ordo salutis, the Holy Spirit regenerates the heart, allowing a person to see their sin and misery. And when a person truly does see their sin and misery and realize their guilt before God, they will turn from that sin and they will trust in the person and work of Christ on their behalf. And so, in so doing, a person is able to recover God's original design for their lives and continue to pursue God's design. And this is, the book doesn't really dwell on this much, but this is where I would like to emphasize, you know, it's all by grace. You know, we've experienced God's saving grace in our lives. And so we are clothed with the righteousness of Christ at that very moment. As Luther said, it's an alien righteousness. So we're clothed with the righteousness of Christ. When God looks at us, he sees the righteousness of his son. And by his grace, we continue to grow in our saving knowledge of Christ. And so it's not something that we do on our own, it's all of God's doing through Christ. We continue to depend upon him. And as far as Scroggins talks about the past, right? We don't have to go back and undo these broken areas in our lives or undo some of the damage that was done relationally, professionally, because of a life of sin, but we begin living our lives anew for our Savior by his grace from that moment on. And of course, as Packer would say, Scroggins would say, there is not only a call to repent and believe, but there really is a call for a response. You know, what say you concerning this good news that you've heard? And in the book, Turning Everyday Conversations into Gospel Conversations, they have a green light, a yellow light, and a red light. Well, of course, the red light is someone simply saying, no, thank you. The yellow light is someone saying, that sounds interesting. I'd like to talk more, which you should. And then, of course, there's the green light, someone who realizes their condition before God and turns from sin and trusts in the saving work of Christ on their behalf. And so there has to be an opportunity to respond, a call for a response, a summons to respond. And that really does encapsulate the full message there. Any questions on the three circles? All right. So we ask the question again, you know, our church's commitment, in light of what we've heard, our church's commitment to evangelism. And what we want to do really is think about, as church leaders, how can we move the needle? That's all we want to do, is move the needle in the right direction in becoming refocused on the Great Commission. We can go to the book of Acts there. We see the purpose of the church. And here we see worship, discipleship, fellowship, service, outreach, and evangelism taking place here in this verse 47. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. And so all of those six purposes or so taking place in the church, we see that evangelism also was a part of that, as the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. And just, this is just kind of my feeble attempt to show how evangelism, through evangelism, someone being converted to the faith, coming into the covenant of grace, what flows out of that? Worship, discipleship, and fellowship. And when we look at service, outreach, mercy, and justice, all those three, four components there, they really create opportunities to establish a relationship with those who are far away from God in order to share the good news of God's saving love for them in Jesus Christ. And so evangelism is huge in our churches. It opens up the door for worship, discipleship, and fellowship, and it creates opportunities, and we create opportunities for it through establishing a relationship with those who are far away from God. And so some practical things that we can do as church leaders. The first is, of course, is prayer. And what we would say concerning prayer is, I like C.S. Lewis's quote. He says it's something that we are reluctant to begin and delighted to finish. And so prayer is a discipline, because we know that prayer aligns our hearts with God. As church leaders, one of the things that's important for us to do here is be intentional about prayer. And how many people do we know? And is it a practice of ours if we keep a prayer journal, who are we praying for that we know? And how are we praying for them? It could be family, neighbor, co-worker, or friend, or that FFG means someone who is far from God. Who are those names that we can put in those blocks? And we understand that prayer is a discipline, but if we truly are going before God and in a regular and consistent basis, and we are asking and entreating God to give us opportunities to share the gospel, when those opportunities come, we should not be surprised. And so church leaders should take great note of this, that establishing an evangelistic and building an evangelistic culture in our churches, it does not begin with strategy. Rather, it truly does begin with prayer. So the next thing here on the list is choose a gospel tool. This is something that the Three Circles tool is the tool that the EPC has adopted. And we've already shown how it's consistent with a biblical theological model and also a systematic theological model, because it does give us the gospel facts. And we have God's design. And so we have creation, we have sin and brokenness, fall, we have the gospel, repent and believe, restoration, and recover and pursue God's design speaks of consummation. And so we have the gospel facts here in the tool, and it's relational, and it can be adapted to any context. And it really is a matter of getting together and training the congregation to use the tool. And this is where churches can be creative. How can you train the congregation to use the tool? Small groups, sermons, specialized training sessions. Think of Saturday morning for an hour with coffee. We throw the Three Circles up on the screen. We sit down, we make a case for it, and we have people practice. with one another. Something that Scroggins mentions in the book is how do you pivot in the conversation in order to get to a gospel conversation? Now, some people, the Lord has gifted them to do this with strangers, and some people, absolutely, with those in whom they have relationships with. Confirmation classes, you can practice at staff meetings, ministry retreats, session meetings. The session, it should really start with the session. Let's take 10, 15 minutes to go over some scenarios and draw the three circles with one another. And one of the things that Scroggins says in his book is to think like trainers and not necessarily teachers. As I think that's pretty important as well. If we have that mindset, then we're really thinking practically as to how we can achieve this goal. So think like trainers, not necessarily teachers. And then, of course, engage with people far from God. If we're gonna choose the tool, train on the tool, then we've got to practice real time, and encouraging our congregation then to utilize that tool. This really leads to number five. It is emphasizing rapid obedience. You know, Scroggins would say that, you know, the most excited about sharing the faith are those who have been recently converted, because they don't know what they don't know. They know that the gospel has saved my life, and I want to share this good news with you. We put this tool into their hands, and the first thing they're going to do are talk to their friends and talk to their unsaved family members, and they're going to share the gospel with them. And with Scroggins and his crew, the reason why they say emphasizing rapid obedience, because it's consistent with their objective of establishing 100 churches. And so they have a practice of overseeding. They want to spread as much gospel seed in their ministry radius as possible. And so we don't necessarily want new believers or new members to the church, you know, say, hey, you're in the church now, you've taken membership vows, now we need you to get into a small group. Well, that's a great opportunity not to push them in small groups or push them through the various steps of membership integration, but rather let's train you to go out and share this good news of the gospel that brought you in. And so it's really changing our paradigm sometimes as to how we think. Coordinate air and ground war. So we think that the air war is the vision and the motivation of the church. And so what is the mission? What is the vision and the values of your church? That is the air war. And the ground war is the strategy that you employ in order to meet that objective. And so this strategy, in the same way, that just like we talked about the different contexts of training, this ground war, what does the worship service look like when it comes to evangelism? What kind of ministry events do we have in which evangelism which creates an opportunity for evangelism? What about our new members class? Do we talk about evangelism in our new members class? What kind of emphasis do we put on us as a Great Commission church in that? And what does hospitality look like, both individually in the home and also in the church? Is it geared towards evangelism, or is it just doing good for goodness sake? And so we coordinate the air war with the ground war. And of course, ultimately the air war is to make disciples. And so on the ground, how are we supporting that overall initial goal, that vision and that mission? Part of the way that we can do that is to create bottleneck conversations. And this is really repetitive, but we really have to think about how we can integrate the evangelism conversation in all areas of ministry. So think about this bottleneck. What what is that avenue that everyone in the church has to go through? New members class is one. Baptism classes is another. Person's going to get baptized. It's a great opportunity for discuss evangelism. What does small group ministries look like? Are we talking about evangelism in small groups? Prayer meetings. If some churches have meet the pastors after church, what kind of conversations are we having there? So in other words, what are the speed bumps that everyone have to pass through or go over in order to in the church that are common to everyone, where these conversations can be had? And we do ourselves a good service. One of the things that I do in counseling, I start off every counseling session with the three circles, because ultimately I want to get to the gospel being the answer to the issue. And one of the ways to practically work that out is to draw the three circles and apply whatever that issue is to the gospel. Could be premarital counseling, just ordinary, regular counseling sessions, discipleship, one-on-ones, anything that is common for members. How can we include the conversation? Involve children and youth ministries. This is pretty huge for us as well. It's not only children and youth ministries. How can this be a part of every ministry in your church? The men's ministry, the women's ministry, greeter ministry, in the diaconate, the session as well. Think of the ministries of the church. So for instance, every fourth Sunday, we have our children will invite friends, and then we draw the three circles. Before VBS, when we do VBS training, for worker training, we draw the three circles. Think of everything that's all things children's ministry. How can you incorporate an evangelistic aspect in that ministry? And the same can be said of our youth ministries as well. In our youth ministry here at TCC, they close every meeting with role playing on sharing your faith. And then whoever the two that have volunteered to role play, they draw the circles on the whiteboard, and they have conversations and they dialogue about it. And so how can it be regular and consistent in the ministries of the church? Collect stories. If there are stories, and what I like about collecting the stories, we're not just collecting stories of someone who saw their need for a savior, repented from sin and became a Christian, but we're also collecting stories of those who are sharing their faith regularly and consistently. Those who are sharing their faith who were less inclined to do so, you know, prior to training. And so we want to collect varied stories of all sorts, and not necessarily focusing on the successes, but but focusing also on the faithfulness of those who are sharing their faith. And then celebrate God's stories. And this is, I put this here after reading what Scroggins wrote. And one of the easiest ways to celebrate God's stories really is in baptism. When those who are being added daily, monthly, weekly to the churches, through the grace of God at work in their lives. And of course, that works itself out in the sacrament of baptism. And so basically, what we really tried to show was churches must focus and must be committed to becoming Great Commission churches. And in order to embrace, in order to build a culture of evangelism, it has to be embraced. And not only does it have to be embraced, but it does have to be an ethos in the church. And then once it's been established as an ethos and as a value in the church, then it just gets very practical. How can we now do this? What is our game plan for making this happen? And, you know, it doesn't happen overnight, but it does start with the church leadership being committed to it, and then working together by God's grace and seeing it to fruition in the congregation. So let me close in prayer and we will conclude. Lord, we thank you for our time together. And it is the cry of our hearts, Lord, that we would be obedient to your great commission, your command of us, your church. We think of the faithful who have gone before us, Lord, and we recognize how they faithfully and boldly witnessed to your good news and how, Lord, you honored that. And so we pray that you would grant all of our sessions and church leaders, Lord, the willingness and the grace, Heavenly Father, to embrace evangelism in their churches. And we pray, Lord, that you would grant them wisdom and collective wisdom and insight to be able to properly communicate it with love and grace to the congregation as well. And Lord, we pray that our obedience, that you would honor our obedience, and that the fruit and the seed that's planted would speak to a great harvest at your appointed time. And all of this we ask and more in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.